In 2005, St. Louis County and St. Louis City came out with a 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. Here we are 10 years later and more homeless than we ever had before. We're going to take a look at that during this program. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. In August 2005, the City of St. Louis and St. Louis County came out with a 10-year plan, and 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness for the City of St. Louis and St. Louis County. Here we are 10 years later, and more homeless than ever before. And instead of admitting that they've utterly failed, they're trying to eliminate New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust from sheltering the homeless people and giving the people a voice through this medium so that you can see directly that when the other media covers their PR campaigns and they try to just tell you their side of the story, you're getting the rest of the story as you tune into these programs here. They don't like that. And that's why they're doing everything they can to try to destroy New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust Street. How are they doing this? By saying you can't take 300 people in. You can take 32 in, and then the rest of you got to put out. And we have 50 people that are living here in transitional housing like Scott and many others. And Scott, your take on all this.
Well, you know, having read through that report to refresh my memory, and I actually helped take part in the drafting of the response to this at the request of the city and the county when I was working for Salvation Army Disaster Services. And we were pushing them to recognize the fact that what we have is an ongoing chronic disaster situation. We have, you know, the city says, their concern is chronically homeless people, which they define as people who have been homeless for longer than 3 years. So,
yes, I have that right in front of me. I don't want to interrupt you, but I have it right here. The U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development defines a chronically homeless person as an unaccompanied homeless individual with a disabling condition who has either been continuously homeless for a year or more or has had four episodes of homelessness in the past 3 years. Now, what Scott's referring to is that if you leave somebody on the street for any period of time and there's no place that they can check into and get shelter in their time of need, they're going to get caught in this system and they're going to end up becoming chronically homeless. And that's what's happening. And as we continue to bring you these programs and introduce you to people, as we do in program after program, they're angry over that. They want to shut it down. They want to silence our voice on all of this. They say, well, you got to go out and you got to get a hotel permit. Here we are, a church. How does a church get a hotel permit? What if they ask your church to do that? Then they came back and said, well, with a hotel permit, you got to get a commercial occupancy permit. How can a church do that? We are a church here. Then they finally said, you don't need either one of those permits, but you got to get a permit. We say, okay, which permit? Tell us how to do it. They don't want to do that. They just keep bringing it up in these court documents. And I have a complete box of documents. I mean, it's that big, this box is, just since this whole trial thing started, in the end of February, the 1st of March. So, I mean, this, and they've assigned five attorneys are coming at New Life Evangelistic Center. Four from the city of St. Louis, one downtown business interest, and then went through the discovery. We've discovered that in September of 2012, they put barricades up and they were determined then they were going to shut New Life down. That was the same month that Slim Cox died, September 2012. And so they've declared all out war as we've questioned their 10-year policy. We did not become a member of their continuum of care because the continuum of care is controlled by the city of St. Louis. We refuse to be a city or a county puppet. Again, the county is directly involved in this too. They do nothing and they just channel their money to the city and they both just kind of wash their hands to it all. But we want to tell you the rest of the story.
Yes, sir. A lot of our patient population or our client population are people who may or may not meet the definition of chronically homeless, but a great number of them are people who have serious underlying mental illness, which is one of the reasons why they can't live with their families any longer, because they've got, you know, they have outbursts. Some of them are drug abusers or alcoholics trying to treat what truly is mental health problems, because there's not enough mental health money in the system or access to the system because of limited availability for people who have no insurance or no Medicaid, that, you know, these people are out on the streets getting worse by the day.
Now, you used to indicate it. You used to work for the Salvation Army. You
yes,
lost
sir.
Your home through a tornado. You were actually doing volunteer work with the Salvation Army, Red Cross, to help tornado victims, poured hot water on yourself. You had to go to the hospital, and then when they wanted to release you, and you're a veteran, you couldn't even go to the Salvation Army anymore because Salvation Army is part of the city's continuum of care, 3010 Washington. They used to have Harbor Light there. They shut it down, totally shut it down.
Yeah. Yeah, there were, at one time, there were 100 beds that were dedicated just to up to 30 days of emergency shelter. And there were another 20 beds that were administered by Grace Hill that were literally temporary housing for people with medical conditions, which didn't allow them the mobility to go out and even look for an apartment. I had the ability to go out and put down the money to get into another domicile, but I didn't have the ability. I wasn't able to walk.
And so, as a result, this is the only place you had to come to.
Yes, sir.
How would you respond? How would you testify if they said, in response to them trying to make it look like New Life and the homeless people serving as a nuisance, and New Life needs to stop taking care of these people?
Well, I mean, I joined the two-year program largely because I felt that this was the only organization that had both the moral direction, the Christian basis from Matthew 25, and the will to continue despite everything the city was trying to do so that they would control 100% of whatever funds were available, that this was the only place that was truly oriented by mission and by practice to serving those people who were underserved by the city. The city's big plan, because that's the way that the federal government was directing them to go, was a program called Housing First, mm-hmm. where they were going to get all these people and put them in housing, and a lot of times it was individual housing. And the people with mental illnesses were not able, in that situation, they needed to be in a group home. But the state of Missouri eliminated most of the group home financial support and personnel support. And nobody was taking up the slack for trying to provide for these people. And the city, by saying only chronically homeless people would be eligible for the HUD-administered housing that they had, over time, you know, they're trying to put the best face on this that they possibly can to continue to get money from the federal government, because it isn't coming out of the city budget. It's federal funds. And the city wanted every federal dollar in the region passed through itself, because out of that they can support their own administrative costs. But part of the problem here is, while this program was supposedly in effect, that they were going to get these people out into low-cost, subsidized housing, the city was doing everything it could to condemn low-cost, subsidized housing and turn it over to private developers. They were using eminent domain law to eliminate the very types of affordable housing that they said they were trying to get these people into.
Did y'all hear what he just said? That the biggest problem in this whole thing is the city of St. Louis. The biggest slumlord is the city of St. Louis. Look at their LRA, their land realization, and they don't like us saying that. So what they're trying to do is shut us up, quiet us up. They don't want it coming through on these programs at all. You know, so they declare them a nuisance. They're a nuisance. They irritate us. We don't like them. Downtown businesses, we don't want them in the neighborhood. So here we are fighting five attorneys coming from every different direction. Then we get a call from the city attorney and says, well, we haven't had, even though we just had an inspector here 2 weeks ago, well, we want to send another inspector through and go from place to place, room to room. And, you know, you can find everything and anything and whatever it is, but we're going to just continue to remain steadfast. This is not a time to be living in fear. We saw the Lord take Moses and the children of Israel through the Red Sea. We saw the walls of Jericho fall down under Joshua's prayers and leadership. And this is not a time to live in fear. And it's fear what causes the Salvation Army to shut down 3010 Washington. It's fear that keeps St. Patrick Center and the rest of them jumping when the mayor says jump because they're afraid they're going to lose their funding.
Yes, sir. Well, and it's odd, too, that I mean, this town has a great Catholic history. Mm-hmm. A lot of philanthropy was performed by individual Catholics in this town, not necessarily the church, but, you know, quite often individual parishes have looked at the lack in supportive services for those people most in need and have looked at their own religious practices and said, if we're going to call ourselves Christians, as Christ admonished us in the 25th chapter of Matthew, then we have to do these things. We have to house the homeless, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit those sick and in prison. Most of the money in the city that's available for various programs to rehouse people, to train people, to put people subsidized jobs for 6 months, goes through St. Patrick's Center and Catholic Charities.
Yes, and then when an agency like New Life wants to follow the mandates of Scripture, do what Jesus told them to do as a church, then they try to silence that voice, and we can't let it be silenced. There's too many women out there, too many children out there, and veterans. Scott, you're a veteran.
Yes, sir.
You know, without New Life Evangelistic Center being open throughout the night, how many veterans that were willing to die for this country could die on our streets?
At least a dozen that I know of who were our clients, who we have a couple of them right now that are in our transitional housing program.
Yes.
You know, because there was no other housing available. The Veterans Administration got funded last year with this big boost in funds to put people in apartments for 6 months with all their bills paid. And unfortunately, the apartments that the city made available to them, a lot of those apartments came with pre-existing debt burden because the former occupants had not paid their utilities. So a lot of these veterans moved into these apartments, and 2 days later, their power was cut off.
Yes.
So they found that this was not the deal that they thought it was going to be.
And then 6 months later, if they don't have a job, they're back out on the streets. Right. They're right back at New Life Evangelistic Center, aren't they?
Yes, sir.
Let's go to Ray as he talks to one of the individuals that had stayed at New Life. That's back, coming for help.
As we help different people coming for utilities, food and clothing and things, I often run into people that at one time in their lives did stay at the shelter here. Our shelter has housed thousands and thousands of people over the years. And I'm talking now with Reginald, and you said that you used to stay here. Now you do have a place, and you're needing a little bit of help on your utility bill. Tell us about that, would you?
Okay, well, like I said, I stayed here once before, and the Lord blessed me to get an apartment. I ran across some hard times, you know, and I reached into my resources and came back down and asked for some help.
Are you working now, or what type of income do you have?
Well, like I said, I'm on disability, which is a fixed income, you know, and I'm working toward finding another place where I can lower my rent and maintain my bills, you know what I'm saying? And at this present time, you know, I need my lights and gas on because, you know, it's with my medicine and stuff like that, I have to keep that cool and stuff like that. So I really appreciate this.
Well, we thank the Lord for bringing you to that place where you're no longer on the streets. That's a definite step in the right direction, and we want to help you now to maintain that and be able to keep your health. And it all takes people pulling together, and we thank God that God has brought you this far, and we want to encourage you to continue to look to Him.
Oh, okay. Like, at the same time, I want to thank you all and thank Reverend Rice and you for the assistance.
I'm back with one of the veterans that Scott and I were referring to earlier. Tell everyone your name.
My name is Mr. Robert Kennedy.
And Robert, how important is it to you that New Life was there for you? What if the city and the county had succeeded in their efforts to silence this voice and, you know, and just said, no, we're not going to let them take them in anymore? What would happen to you as a veteran?
Well, as a veteran, I would be still on the street just wondering where I'm going to live and what I'm going to eat that day. But since I came here, I don't have that problem anymore.
You had a place you were able to come. We have a 90-day veterans program. By the way, we not only have a program in St. Louis like this, we have our Veterans Coming Home Center in Springfield, Missouri. So, again, in Springfield, Missouri, New Life Evangelistic Center on the front line helping veterans. And I want you to pray for Springfield, Missouri. New people in Springfield, get involved at the Veterans Coming Home Center in Springfield, Missouri. But Robert is with me at this time. He's in our program here. You came here. What does it mean to a person to be able to just have a place to lay your head, store your belongings, shower, and eat regularly.
Oh, it means a lot, a whole lot. I mean, what else could you do? It's just being on the street. You can't do that out in the street. I mean, not the way you really want to.
That's your dog tag around your neck there?
Well, it's not a really exactly a dog tag. It's something that the veteran sends you and thanking you for your service.
Oh, is it? So it represents that?
Yes, sir.
When were you in the armed services?
I was in 73, and I was in the Marine Corps.
And for how long?
5 years. Four years.
Sorry. Where were you stationed at?
I was stationed in San Diego, but I went to Okinawa, Japan, and a couple more places.
A lot of people have a hard time believing that veterans can actually be homeless.
Yes, sir.
You know,
I
mean, these men and women that were willing to die to protect the freedoms that we enjoy in this country, being on the streets. Now, there's a lot of PR out there, and if you sit back and you believe everything you read or see or hear, you think that the politicians are taking care of all of it because they tell you that, so that you vote for them again the next time around. But the reality of it all is something totally different when you yourself at 10 o'clock at night without any place at all to go. Where's the place they tell them to come to when they want on the streets?
Come to Larry Rice Intervention Center. Yes, sir.
They tell them to come here. Is that right?
All the time. They even drop them off here sometimes.
Yeah. You've seen
that? I've seen that. I didn't believe until I actually saw it.
What'd you see?
Well, I actually saw two police officers take a guy out of handcuffs and just set him down right in front of your building and just drove away.
That's what happens on a nightly basis.
Right.
The police, and then when it's time, the trial comes, what happens, the politicians get the lieutenant to come and testify against us, and his men are dropping them off here all
exactly.
night. This is what we're encountering, folks. And this is why I need you to go to God in earnest prayer and share that much-needed tax-deductible gift from New Life Evangelistic Center, as we have to stand up against 5 attorneys, 1 by the downtown business interests and 4 attorneys on the part of the mayor's office. What they did is they're using tax dollars, funding 4 attorneys to do everything they can to stop New Life, as we desire to help the veterans, the women, the children, the elderly, in the middle of the night. I'm asking you to pray and join us in praying as we come against this ungodliness that results in unbelievable human suffering. I need you to pray for us at this particular time, because brothers and sisters, not only are they trying to attack through the 4 attorneys from the city like that and the others, now they're saying, well, we want to come in and do a very detailed 4x4 inspection. Well, you know, inspectors have come in here all the time, all the years we've been open. We try to accommodate what they're trying to do. But I mean, if they're just going to be coming in to just pick and pick and pick, well, then we're just going to have to come to you and say, okay, we're just going to continue to do even a better job. That's what we're going to do. That's why we want to get everything down just right, as they say it, when they come through. That's why we record it all, but so we can get it done right. But then we'll have to probably come back and say, look, we got to fix all this stuff up. Well, we got to do what we got to do, but we got to stay open, because the people have nowhere else to go. And Jesus told us to do that. Hmm. Remember the homeless Jesus, Matthew 8:20. He said, foxes have holes, birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, nowhere to lay his head. We have a 5-foot statue of Jesus on a park bench in the lobby of our facility here. When you see that, what thoughts go through your mind?
Oh, when I see that, a lot of things go through my mind. I was like, Jesus was actually homeless, and here I am homeless too. That's like we're brothers.
we're what? Let them hear that again.
We're brothers.
Brothers. In other words, society makes you feel like you're subhuman.
Yeah.
The people out there in the downtown business interests, whether it's St. Louis, whether it's Clayton, whether it's Belleville, whether it's Springfield, make you feel like you're subhuman.
Right.
But here, that Jesus would care.
Right.
That
exactly.
Jesus, fully God, becomes fully man and comes in doing the very same thing that you found yourself thrust into. That's encouraging.
Yes,
it
is really encouraging. I mean, every time I pass through that, I actually do. When I pass through that lobby, I actually put my hand on it and just keep going.
And that's just a symbol of our resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, no longer the homeless Jesus, who fully gave up his place in heaven to come and dwell among us here. And I don't know if you really appreciate him unless you've really been homeless like that and have nowhere else to go but call out to God in the heavens.
Right.
And then you see him directing them to this place, the last major walk-in shelter. You're an answer to somebody's prayer tonight, each and every one of you that are donating New Life Evangelistic Center at this hour of great need. P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166. P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. 1-800-334-3276. You can make a pledge. You can use your MasterCard or Visa. And we get you a miniature statue for every gift of $200 or more like that you can put on your desk like I have on my desk. And as I look at that, I remember the cry to pray from Lamentations 3. Lamentations 3, I believe it's verse 20, that it says, Will you raise up your hand and will you cry out unto the Lord for the child that's on the street, for the one that's hurting, the one that's suffering out there? I want to respond. There's so many people suffering out there. And during your time here, you've seen some of those people, haven't you?
Yes, I've seen a lot of those people. I mean, it's unbelievable how many people are homeless. But really, what really hurts me is the children that comes in here who really don't really understand being homeless.
You ever seen those women come in between like after 8 o'clock at night with those little children?
Yes, it's heartbreaking.
And you would know that if New Life did what the county, and the city and the mayor and the lawyers that work for the city, those four attorneys and the ones that work for the downtown business center, did what they wanted to do, we'd have to lock those mamas and babies out on the street. When you see them sleeping in here on this floor in this worship studio, you see them coming to the doors like that. I mean, knowing that the cry of the child will be going forth every night and some will be dying out there. Some families will be destroyed because they'll be ripped out of the mother's hands and put in foster care. All because of greedy, self-centered interests of a few. We can look at the hideous crimes done against the American Indian, the killing off all the buffalo just to destroy and starve the Indian into submission. Mm. We see what they did to the African American, and the slavery and a civil war had to be fought over that. There's another civil war going on right now. It's being fought in the courts. It's going to start taking place in the September. Yes, in the 8th Circuit Court. They've already they've got a witness list. It's got, I don't know how many witnesses on there. I don't know how long it's going to go. We need your prayers, brothers and sisters, right now. We're right in the thick of the battle because we refuse to compromise. We refuse to become a part of the city-controlled continuum of care and just jump when the mayor says jump and be scared of them like these other agencies are. We need your help. We need your prayers. And I thank God for those that are doing that. And you as a veteran, I know you're thankful too, aren't
you? Yes, I'm thankful. I finally been able to get my housing in. I'm proud to at least have my housing.
And not only is the homeless, so many others are having utilities shut off and they're coming to New Life.
We're talking with Richard May, who's come to New Life Evangelistic Center for help. You're in danger of having your electric shut off. And I know life can be pretty challenging at times. I see that you have you walk with a crutch.
Yeah.
Can you tell us, did you injure your leg?
I was on a job and a guy was not paying attention and he actually ran over my foot and crushed it. And I have 3 broken bones in my foot, nerve damage, and they also had to take 3 of my toenails off. So as far as me working right now, it's not something that I can actually just go out and do right now. It's a little bit difficult for me to actually just go out and work. And I have to wait for a release form from my job, from my doctor, yeah, to actually get back.
Do you get any kind of unemployment compensation?
Well, they pay workman's comp, but you know, most people know how the workman's comp system goes. They pay you 60% of your check, which is real tough to deal with when you got 2 kids, bills, and you know, you got an actual life to live. So it's a little bit rough.
I'm sure your check wasn't that high in the first place, so 60% of it is not that much.
No, it's not. I mean, I want to thank the church, though, for actually giving me a chance, you know, helping me out with whatever they can help with, and I just put it in God's hands from here.
Well, God bless you. We're glad that we can be here. I mean, that's what we want to do, is help people like Richard, who are, you know, working people or really trying to do the right thing, take care of your family. How many children do you see here?
I have 2 boys.
And how old are they?
9 and 2.
Wow. So you want to help them out. You don't want them to be in a house that's dark and, you know, in this hot weather like that. And so we're going to make a pledge today, and hopefully we can help you to keep your electric on.
All right. I want to say thank you to this church. And if there was anything I could do to help you all, I would.
God bless you. Thank you.
It's not just the homeless. People getting injured on the job. People losing it all. People not knowing which way to turn. How can New Life help them except through those that are caring and sharing at this time? Please pray for us. We're our needy fund. We take 10% of the gifts that we get to help just pay the legal expenses and fix the building up. 5% in our mission fund, 5% our needy fund. And then we try to respond to these individuals' cries for help like this. But we have to keep the building open. We have to raise $110,000 at this time. $110,000 at this particular time. We need you to be praying for us. $80,000 for legal expenses, $30,000 just for immediate repairs needed on the building at this particular time. And when they do their walkthrough, if they find this and that and everything else, it's all in the hands of Jesus. That's all I can say. Mm-hmm. I just want to serve Jesus. I got to trust Jesus. I couldn't get out of bed in the morning with it all if I didn't know that there's a God in the heavens and he'll provide that miracle. And I've been having to live like this for over 43 years, and it'll be 44 in January, and he sustains us, he takes care of us, and I know he'll do the same thing for you. So come on, arise and shine. Let the light and love of Jesus flow in you and through you, for greater is he who's in you than he that's in the world. Let's believe God. We have but one life to live. Let's live it for the glory of God. We don't know when he's going to call us home. Disease can strike just like that. A twist of the wheel can cause us to be wiped out in an automobile accident. Miss a few heartbeats and we're out of it. But what have we done for the glory of God? He says, store up your treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy. Let's continue to live for Jesus. And I thank God for those of you that are doing that are partnering with New Life Evangelistic Center. Some of you shared those $200 gifts requested that statuette. May God bless you in a very, very special way. We thank God for those of you that are sharing at this particular time. And there's many of you that just can't share $200, but you become a Club 24 member. What a blessing you are, partnering that way. 80 cents a day, $24 a month. You make it possible for our veterans. Yes, like Scott, like Robert here, and for the mamas and the babies to have a place to sleep at night. And if you're not a Club 24 member, please call now and become one. 1-800-334-3276. Not only does that keep our facilities open in St. Louis, but throughout Central Missouri training programs in Marshfield and Joplin and in Springfield, Missouri. Be a part wherever you're at. Please call now, 1-800-334-3276. You can use your MasterCard, Visa card, credit card, and make your first gift of $24 and say, I want to become a Club 24 member. And Robert, I know those Club 24 members, and I know those individuals have been sharing. They were an answer to your prayers, weren't they?
Yes, sir, they really were.
And you're moving to your own place now.
Yes, I'll be leaving tomorrow.
Are you excited about it?
Yes, I'm really. So I think I've been here long enough.
Broke the cycle of homelessness.
Sir. Yes, it
didn't
did.
Didn't get sucked into that chronic homelessness that, you know, the city's got this plan. Now, let me reach down here and grab that real quick here.
Okay.
A 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. Here it is, 10 years later, and there's a lot of them out there in there.
Yes, it is.
A lot of them still caught in that cycle, right?
There's a lot of them.
The New Life Evangelistic Center believes this, that if we don't give them a place to sleep, if we don't have doors open so they can get off the streets like Robert does, if they don't have a walk-in shelter they come to in any hour, day or night, and they learn how to bounce from this shelter to that shelter, this shelter, that shelter, call the hotline, go here, there, and everywhere, go over to 12th and Park, and meet at Centenary at 4:30 in the afternoon, bust over there, drop back out on the street, bust over, back on the street, they're going to end up homeless. Yes. And we're telling you the rest of the story in this program, and they're trying to shut us down. They're trying to silence this media. They're trying to stop the homeless from coming here and telling their stories. And there's put four attorneys on it to try to quiet us. Greater is he who's in us than he that's in the world, and we're still open. We're still open. I looked out there the other day and saw they had their barricades up since September 2012, and the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart. You're still there, Larry.
Mm.
You're still there, right?
Okay. Wow.
And we found our way through discovery that they were determined in September 2012 to totally silence us, shut us down. We put the barricades for a while in front of the building. We let them know they couldn't do that legally. So then they got this guy at the parking lot, kept calling the police all the time, and then built his little case, and they own the condominium buildings over there, and they get all the condominium people to sign that, and then he hires the attorney. That's one of those attorneys, the other four out of the city, and, you know, checking out how many contributions they've given all these people to the mayor so for his reelection. Mm-hmm. And then here they are, they're coming in so viciously. Because we're telling you that this plan has failed. It's failed. And we let you talk to the people. And we're letting you hear from people that will literally die out on those streets. Veterans, women, children. If it wasn't for those of you supporting New Life Evangelistic Center, helping to save lives. And not only save lives, but Robert, they're saving souls too, aren't they?
Yes, we are. We're really doing it. I really appreciate it.
You've gone closer to Jesus by being here?
A lot closer, yes. So, I mean, I really got closer to him than I was before I came here.
It's a holistic program, something that these government programs can't do, won't do, and afraid to do. Yeah. You're not afraid to let them know that there's hope. Christ is risen. And I know you're not afraid either. And that's why you are generously sharing at this time and getting your church directly involved. Where's your church going to drop them off at 1411 Locust out open? Where's the hospital's going to bring them? Where's the police department's going to bring them? We need you at this time. Again, it's the New Life Evangelistic Center. P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. You can give online at www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.com. .org. And if you feel them coming at you from every direction, remember, greater is he who is in you, that's Jesus, than the devil is out there in the world.
That's right.
Let's stand steadfast. Let's believe God together. Let's pray together. This is a battle that involves all of us. If they can knock this church off, your church next. Come on, folks, get with it. Get your church directly involved also with the work of New Life Evangelistic Center.